Well, hey, thanks for being here with us today. Yeah. I appreciate it. I'm Jason. I'm with All Things Open. I'm here with Brandon. Please introduce yourself.
Yeah, Jason. I mean, first of all, thanks so much for having me on. I'm Brandon Mathis, freelance full stack developer. I've been building web and mobile applications for going on about 15 plus years now. And live here, Raleigh, North Carolina, all my life, local to the North Carolina Triangle area.
Great. So. Well, thanks for being with us today. Let's talk about GraphQL. Please just tell us what it is. And for those not familiar with it, just a brief introduction.
Yeah. So GraphQL is a query language standard that really came to popularity in 2016, 2017 is where it took off. I first heard about GraphQL when I attended a conference called Full Stack Fest out in Barcelona, of all places, and people were talking about some really interesting things. And one of the topics that frequently came up was GraphQL. At the time, I was building all of my APIs in REST, and the idea of having a API that has this form of schema attached to it that defines all the attributes that may be on a certain resource that can be modified, the types of those attributes and things of that nature, was really intriguing for me, because the thing, you know, as a individual who builds and crafts APIs every day, building my API was never really the hard part. The hard part was explaining to people how to use it, how to interface with it, what can it do, what can it change, and how it is that you talk to me, all the way from creating a resource to getting an error back. GraphQL, being that it's a defined specification, it provides a lot of answers to these questions for you that many teams have to sit down and go, okay, our REST API might have sent an error. How do we respond back with that? With GraphQL, having a defined type of, you know, what your API is going to do under that scenario is really nice. So it is... Yeah, I could keep going on and on, because yeah. I mean, there's a lot about GraphQL. I mean, there's a lot to explore. I always like to say first that it is a standard. It is not a technology per se. So you can install technologies that implement the GraphQL standard. Apollo is a really, really popular one, often used on the front end and on the back end. I very much enjoy using is Ruby GraphQL. I like to use Ruby on Rails to build GraphQL APIs and do so frequently. And, it is at the end of the day, the only thing you're doing is you are following a standard by which, you know, how are you going to send queries out to a backend system and how is that system going to respond? Even things like HTTP and stuff like that, you could implement a GraphQL API without HTTP. You could do it using RabbitMQ if you wanted to. And that was really, really intriguing to me, because so many things about REST were hard reliant on HTTP, which is interesting. So,
well, let me ask this. You've been quoted as saying that the future is GraphQL. What do you mean by that?
I think the future is GraphQL because, you know, with... back to kind of like, you know, my struggle building REST APIs, I spent so much time conversing with engineering teams, engineers inside my own team and engineers in other companies or engineers that work for my customer company, right, about, you know, what this API is going to do. And after using GraphQL for about a year, I realized that my turnaround time for API development was really decreasing. Decreasing almost at an exponential level. I could write a GraphQL query and send it off to someone. And it got to the point where engineers, they wouldn't even hit me back to ask how to use this. They simply open up the GraphQL schema, or there is a thing that comes with GraphQL called the GraphQL Explorer. It can run in the browser and it can help you kind of navigate the API on your own. People didn't have to ask me all these questions like, what do I do? How do I use it? They just really understood, and I didn't have to have that 2-hour long conversation. And then I think other companies started to take notice. And what really kind of drove it home was when I attended GitHub Universe back in 2015, I believe. Oh no, actually that was 2017.
Okay.
They made an announcement that they were going to switch their entire API over to GraphQL. And then I came to All Things Open and I saw companies like Capital One, you know, engineers from PayPal, Bank of America, really large enterprise-sized companies saying, you know, we are making the switch off of REST and we're moving a lot of our APIs over to GraphQL because we find that, you know, by spending less time having to have these conversations back and forth about how the API works, we can focus more time on enhancing the quality of what is they're building, writing automated tests, you know, doing other things. I really feel like it is the decreased burden of documentation that makes like GraphQL a huge, huge front runner for being like, I mean, you know, the API of the future, yeah, maybe it. You could call it.
Well, let's shift focus to the developer then. Yeah. You know, what do teams need to consider as they're looking at possible adoption of GraphQL?
I definitely think so. You know, I say GraphQL is the future because I really like to make strong statements like that. But there are some shortcomings when it comes to GraphQL. One of the things that teams are going to find that they're going to run into is rate limiting API requests becomes a very interesting challenge. With GraphQL, I could query for a book, let's say. But I can also, as a part of that, I can query for chapters in a book and maybe even subcontextual information from there. It's like a tree and it further goes. It drills down even deeper and deeper. You can query in this almost drill down mode. And that means that some queries are far more complex than others.
Okay.
Most REST APIs, when you hit an endpoint, you kind of know the query that it's going to run. The query isn't going to change based on what attributes you're asking for. It's pretty guaranteed it's going to be the same way every time. And that's a really, really controllable thing to rate limit on, to even price around when you're talking about access.
Okay.
Right. So that can be a bit of a challenge for GraphQL, is figuring out, you know, how much is too much? How much is too much for a client to be asking me in terms of data?
Okay. Well, that's good for them to consider.
Yeah. Hey, this is Todd with All Things Open. Thank you so much for watching. We truly appreciate it. Also, be sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the notification button. We've got a lot of new content coming we think you're going to be interested in. One final favor, be sure to go to allthingsopen.org, allthingsopen.org to see everything that we do. Back to the video.
Any best practices that can help the ATO community save time or help people get started more quickly?
I would definitely say a huge best practice with GraphQL is to make sure, if you're thinking about adopting GraphQL, make sure you look up the GraphQL Explorer or any SDK that will implement that inside of your backend system. What that provides you is a user interface that for the most part will run in the web browser. I mean, there are Electron implementations of this and whatnot, but you know, for my use case, it's always web related. So you can have this Explorer run in the browser and you can say, what are all the queries that are available to me right now? And bam, it'll pop it up.
Got it.
And you can start typing queries out and it will autocomplete attributes for you. You can say, what mutations are available to me? It pops it right up. It'll show them all to you. And it'll let you know what resources those mutations are going to respond back with. So, you know, you don't have to go trudging through handwritten documentation with GraphQL. That kind of just documentation has entropy built in. It degrades over time as the API is further expanded. The GraphQL Explorer, I really like it because it notices the updates that you make to your API, and all of your engineers have immediate access to what these updates are, how they work, what they do. I'm a really big fan. And I would also say, too, that if you're looking into using GraphQL, you should explore a little bit using some strongly typed languages. GraphQL is a very type-oriented specification for like an API query language. So using languages like TypeScript is extremely helpful. Go on the back end is really helpful. You know, if you can embrace this idea of static, strongly typed stuff, it will make your GraphQL experience even easier.
Awesome.
So
cool. Thanks. That's great advice.
Yeah.
I know that you run a local meetup here for Triangle developers. Can you tell us more about it?
Yeah. Triangle devs. So it's a newly formed meetup that we formed just this year in 2024. We're just a few shy of about 400 members right now. So it is fast growing, but yeah, tight knit little local meetup. We do have 3 active chapters running right now. We have one in Durham that hosts a regular hack and social night for coders in the Durham, North Carolina area, another out in Holly Springs. And then we do another meetup that's like a talk series, and we have that in downtown Raleigh. So just a fun place for coders, by coders. Come take your laptop, talk about your favorite programming language. just a bunch of nerds hanging out.
Awesome.
You know, networking and getting to know each other in the physical world, though. We keep all of our meetups in a physical space for the most part, because that was a big ask that a lot of people in the area had. They wanted to see that. So I want to see it too. So I decided to take on the challenge myself of making it happen.
It's great to see that craving come back. So, all right, Brandon, thanks for your time today. We'll see you at All Things Open.
Yeah, Jason, I'm looking forward to it.